Welcome to this YouTube channel. In this video we are going to talk about the top 10 facts about Amir Timur. So before starting this video, like this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel for future updates. Amir Timur, also known as Tamerlane, was a Turco-Mongol conqueror who founded the Timurid Empire in and around modern-day Afghanistan, Iran, and Central Asia, becoming the Timurid dynasty's first emperor. He is generally considered as one of history's greatest military figures and tacticians due to his unbeaten record as a general. Timur is often regarded as a great patron of art and architecture due to his interactions with scholars, such as Ibn Khaldun and Hafiz Abu, and the Timurid Renaissance that he initiated during his rule. Here are 10 things you should know about him. Number 10. Timur was born on April 9, 1336, into the Barlas Confederation in Transoxiana, modern-day Uzbekistan, and by 1370 he had taken possession of the Western Chagatai Khanate. After crushing the Mamluks of Egypt and Syria, the emerging Ottoman Empire, and the weakening Delhi Sultanate of India, he led military campaigns through Western, South and Central Asia, the Caucasus, and Southern Russia, emerging as the most dominant ruler in the Muslim world. He founded the Timurid Empire as a result of these conquests, but the empire disintegrated shortly after his death. Number 9. Timur was the last of the great nomadic conquerors of the Eurasian steppe, and his empire paved the way for the more centralized and long-lasting Islamic gunpowder empires to emerge in the 16th and 17th centuries. Timur was of Turkish and Mongol descent, and although he was unlikely to be a direct descendant of Genghis Khan on either side, he did share a common ancestor with him on his father's side, and some scholars have speculated that his mother was a descendant of Khan. He was simply attempting to evoke the legend of the latter's conquests while he was still alive. According to Gerard Chaliand, Timur saw himself as Genghis Khan's successor, and dreamed the restoration of the Mongol Empire of Genghis Khan, died 1227. Beatrice Forbes Manns, a sociologist, believes that Timur continued to represent himself as the restorer of Chinggisid privileges in his official correspondence throughout his life. His wars against the Iranians, Mamluks, and Ottomans is justified as restoring rightful Mongol sovereignty over territories usurped by usurpers. Timur referred to himself as the Sword of Islam to legitimize his conquests by using Islamic imagery and vocabulary. He was a supporter of religious and educational organizations. Over his lifetime, he converted almost all of the Borjigin leaders to Islam. At the Siege of Smyrna, Timur decisively beat the Christian Knights Hospitaller, earning the title of Ghazi. Timur had full control of all the remains of the Chagatai Khanate, the Ilkhanate, and the Golden Horde by the end of his rule, and even tried to revive the Yuan dynasty in China. Number 8. Timur claimed to be a descendant of Tumene Khan, a male line ancestor who shared a male line ancestor with Genghis Khan, through his father. Karachar Noyan, Tumene's great-great-grandson, served as an emperor's minister, and later supported the latter's son Chagatai in the governorship of Transoxiana. Despite the fact that there are few references to Karachar in documents from the 13th and 14th centuries, later, Timurid sources emphasized his importance in the Mongol Empire's early history. The bond of fatherhood and sonship was later created by Genghis Khan by marrying Chagatai's daughter to Karachar, according to these histories. Timur asserted kinship with the Chagatai Khans based on his supposed descent from this marriage. Number 7. Timur and a small band of followers raided travelers for goods, especially livestock such as sheep, horses, and cattle, when he was a boy. Timur is thought to have attempted to rob a shepherd of a sheep in 1363, but was struck by two arrows, one in his right leg and the other in his right hand, where he lost two fingers. He was paralyzed for the rest of his life as a result of all of these injuries. Timur is thought to have received his debilitating injuries while working as a mercenary for the Khan of Sistan in Khorasan in what is now Dasht-e-Margo in southwest Afghanistan. Timur's wounds earned him the nicknames Timur the Lame and Tamerlane among Europeans. Timur rose to fame as a military leader around 1360, commanding a force of mainly Turkic tribesmen from the area. With the Khan of the Chagatai Khanate, he took part in campaigns in Transoxiana. He invaded Khorasan with 1,000 horsemen, allying himself with Kozagin, the dethroner and destroyer of Volga Bulgaria, both in cause and through family relation. This was his second military campaign, and its success prompted him to launch further campaigns, including the conquest of Khwarezm and Urgench. Following the assassination of Kozagin, disagreements emerged among the many claims to sovereign authority. Another son of Genghis Khan, Tula Timur of Kashgar, the Khan of the Eastern Chagatai Khanate, invaded, putting an end to the infighting. Timur was sent to bargain with the invader, but instead chose to accompany him, earning Transoxania as a reward. Timur's father died about this time, and he became head of the Burlas. Tula then tried to establish his son Ilyas Koja as ruler of Transoxania, but Timur was able to repel the invasion with a smaller army. Number 6. As he tried to conquer the Mongol Empire and the Muslim world, Timur's Turco-Mongolian ancestry presented both possibilities and obstacles. Timur could not claim the title of Khan or rule the Mongol Empire, because he was not a descendant of Genghis Khan, according to Mongol traditions. As a result, Timur installed Suyur Gatmish, a puppet Chagatai Khan, as the nominal ruler of Balkh, pretending to be a protector of a Chinggisid line, that of Genghis Khan's eldest son, Hochi. Instead, Timur used the title of Emir, which means general, and acted on behalf of the Chagatai ruler of Transoxania. Timur assumed the title Gurgen, royal son-in-law, when he married Saray Mulk Kanem, a princess of Chinggisid descent, to bolster his status. Number 5. Timur couldn't assume the ultimate title of the Islamic world, Caliph, since the office was exclusive to the Quraysh, the Prophet Muhammad's tribe, just as he couldn't claim the title of Khan. As a result, Timur responded to the challenge by constructing a myth and reputation of himself as a divinely appointed, supernatural personal force. Otherwise, he was identified as a spiritual descendant of Ali, implying that he had ancestors who were both Genghis Khan and Quraysh. Timur invaded northern India in 1398, invading the Sultanate of Delhi, which was administered by the Tughlaq dynasty's Sultan Nasir-ud-Din Mahmud Shah Tughlaq. On September 30, 1398, he sacked Tulamba and massacred its residents after crossing the Indus River. Then he advanced and, by October, had conquered Multan. Much of the Indian aristocracy submitted without a fight, though he did face opposition from a combined army of Rajputs and Muslims under the command of Rao Dul Chand at Botnar. The Rao initially resisted Timur, but when pressed, he considered surrendering. His brother locked him outside the walls of Botnar, and Timur later killed him. The Botnar garrison then fought and were slain down to the last man. Botnar's home was ransacked and set ablaze. Number 4. Timur's march into Delhi was hampered by the Jat peasantry, who looted caravans and then vanished into the mountains. Timur killed 2,000 Jats and kidnapped several more. The Sultanate of Delhi, on the other hand, did little to halt his progress. Timur began a war with Bayezid I, the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire, and Nasir ad-Din Faraj, the Mamluk Sultan of Egypt, before the end of 1399. In Anatolia, Bayezid started annexing the lands of Turkmen and Muslim kings. The Turkmen rulers sought shelter behind Timur as he asserted his authority over them. Number 3. Timur conquered Armenia and Georgia in the year 1400. More than 60,000 locals were taken as slaves, and several districts were depopulated of the remaining population. Shivas, in Asia Minor, was also deposed by him. After that, Timur moved on to Syria, sacking Aleppo and Damascus. Except for the artisans, who were exiled to Samarkand, the city's inhabitants were slaughtered. Timur justified his slaughter of Damascus residents by citing the assassination of Hasan ibn Ali by the Umayyad Caliph Muawiyah I, and the assassination of Husayn ibn Ali by Yazid I. Number 2. In June of 1401, Timur attacked Baghdad. 20,000 of the city's residents were massacred after the city was taken. Any soldier was required to return with at least 2 severed human heads to demonstrate Timur. Many soldiers slaughtered captives captured earlier in the battle when they ran out of men to fight, and when they ran out of prisoners to kill, many resorted to beheading their own wives. Number 1. Timur liked to war in the springtime. He died en route, however, during an uncharacteristically cold winter campaign. Timur launched military operations against Ming China in December 1404, capturing a Ming ambassador in the process. When encamped on the other side of the Sir Daria, he became ill and died at Farab on February 17, 1405, before crossing the Chinese frontier. His grandson Khalil Sultan released the Ming envoys, including Fuan and the rest of the entourage, after his death. What do you think about this video? Do let us know down in the comment section below. If you enjoyed this video and want to hear from us again, be sure to hit that subscribe button before you go.